We now invite Mr. Timothy Hodge, Director of Social Security, to bring the invocation.
Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Lord, for even the showers of blessings that you have blessed our land with. We thank you for all the other blessings that you have bestowed upon us as a people. And Lord, we want to return, Lord, thanks and praise to you. And this evening, as we are gathered here to participate in this lecture, the Social Security Board's lecture series, we thank you for our speaker, our lecturer. We thank you for all who are here present and all those who are listening over the airwaves and who will see this lecture at some point in the future. We ask that it would be good food for thought and that it would help us along the path of sustainable development for our country. Thank you, Lord, once again, and bless everything that be said and done in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hodge. It's a pleasure to be here indeed. Your Excellency, Acting Governor Mr. Perrin Bradley, Honorable Minister for Social Development and Acting Chief Minister Mr. Evans McNeil Rogers, Honorable Ministerial Assistant in the Ministry of Home Affairs, and elected member for Road North, Mrs. Everly Bradley, Mr. Stanley Reed, former Deputy Governor and member of the UWI Open Campus Council, Dr. Oluwakemi Linda Banks, member of the Program Advisory Committee for Behavioral Sciences in the University of the West Indies Open Campus, Chairman of the Anguilla Social Security Board, Mr. Russell Reed, Deputy Chair, Mr. Roy Horsford, Director, Mr. Timothy Hodge, and staff, permanent secretaries, heads of department, the Government of Anguilla, the Professor Delroy Loudon, President of the Anguilla Community College, staff of the UWI Open Campus, and UWI Guild of Students representatives, staff and students of the Albina Lake Hodge Comprehensive School Sixth Form and the Albina Lake Hodge Comprehensive School Literary and Debating Society, students and the head of the Comprehensive Learning Center, as well as the Anguilla Community College in particular, we are so delighted to have you here this evening. And Dr. Emily Dick-Forde, our keynote or lecturer presenter this evening. We are particularly pleased to have you all join us. And without further ado, I am going to invite Mr. Hodge to come back and bring his welcome remarks for this, the second annual Social Security, UWI Open Campus Distinguished Lecture.
Thank you, Dr. Fleming Banks, and just like to adopt the protocol that has been established and to say a special welcome to each and every one of you here this evening, and including our Social Security staff members and the former chairman of the board, Mr. Carl Harrigan. This is a real pleasure that we will tonight have the second Social Security Board UWI Open Campus lecture. And as you might be aware, the Social Security Board some years ago established a lecture series with two lectures, one around Anguilla Day, which is our most important national holiday, and that lecture, the Social Security Board collaborates with the Anguilla Community College. Well, let me not jump ahead. That lecture, the Walter G. Hodge Memorial Lecture, was held and dealt mainly with Anguilla's political development. And then in November, the week in which Social Security Week is comes, falls, which marks the anniversary of the passage of the Social Security Act. Tonight, November 3rd, is actually the actual anniversary, 36th anniversary of the passage of that act. And so we had a lecture series for many years, and then for reasons known only to them, the previous Social Security Board abandoned the lecture series. Last year, beginning with the November 3rd and November 2nd lecture last year, the lecture series was reestablished with the UWI Open Campus and the Social Security Board co-hosting, and the UWI Open Campus providing the lecturer. And anyone who was here last year remembers it was certainly a very enlightening and stimulating lecture. And then in June of this year, the Anguilla Community College teamed up with the Social Security Board to restart the Anguilla Day Lecture. And so we are back. Now, the idea of the theme, which is Social Security, a true commitment to Anguilla's sustainable development, preceded the selection of a lecturer, but we wanted to make sure that the lecture this year would deal with the sustainable development goals established by the United Nations. I won't say too much about that because that's what the lecture is going to be about. But I was afraid that Anguilla is going to be marked, graded against how we do in these SDGs, and nobody was saying anything about them in Anguilla. In fact, the first time I ever heard them mentioned in our local news was the same day that we established that our lecturer would be Dr. Dick-Forde. That morning in the news, there was an item about children and the Sustainable Development Goals. So we are here. Now, and we're very happy to have Dr. Dick-Forde as our lecturer this evening. Now let me give you a little idea about how small this world is. I just asked her a while ago if she was in the Trinidad cabinet at the same time as Mariana Brown, who was the Minister of Finance in the Patrick Manning administration. And she said yes. They took both of us out of Barbados at the same time to join the cabinet in Trinidad. Well, I met Mariana Brown in Barbados. My colleague, former director of Social Security, then permanent secretary to the Prime Minister in Barbados, my very good friend William Lane, was the very good friend of Mariana Brown, and introduced us, and we became friends. And in fact, when I went to Trinidad to a conference, all of my colleagues were in awe as he came down, he spoke to me. They wondered how in the world does he know Tim from Anguilla. Well, when the financial crisis hit in Anguilla, began to hit, even before it began to hit, I picked up the phone one day and I called him and I said, Mariano, we are going to be in for a rough, rough ride in Anguilla. And the only people I see who can provide a way out of this is Trinidad with its oil money. He said, he listened to my argument, he agreed, he said, however, I can't do anything until my prime minister comes back. At that time he was in Cuba undergoing medical treatment. He says when he comes back, I will take it to him. Unfortunately, as soon as he got back from Trinidad, from Cuba, he called elections and his party lost. And one of the very first things his replacement as prime minister said, if you recall, Kamala said, Trinidad is not going to be anybody's ATM machine, right? Right. She's not going to be the Caribbean's ATM machine. So in other words, don't come to Trinidad. So, but had that not happened, in all probability, What I was suggesting, and it wasn't for Anguilla, it was for the OECS, would probably have been discussed in the Trinidad cabinet, and Dr. Dick-Forde would have been there among the cabinet. At that time, I knew nothing about her. In fact, I met her for the first time yesterday. She's a wonderful lady, though. No, so therefore, let's proceed. We are all, I'm sure, anxious to hear what our lecturer will tell us. I'm really gratified that the students are here, because you have got to internalize this more than us, the adults, okay? And help us to work towards Anguilla's sustainable development. So I welcome you all, and look forward to a wonderful evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hodge. And let us congratulate the Anguilla Social Security Board on the 36th anniversary today. And as you would note, Social Security, a true commitment to Anguilla's sustainable development, so fitting to fit into this evening's program. We also want to acknowledge the presence and the contribution of the media, including Radio Anguilla, carrying this live, and ATV, and Mr. Wycliffe Richardson, who's recording it for television and rebroadcast as well. I think it's going to be an exciting evening. Students, we are so happy to see you, so many of you here. Let's give them a round of applause and give yourselves a round of applause. Yes, Charlene. I'm going to ask Miss Michelle Queeley. She's a pelican to the bone, I think. She started out with her undergrad and then a master's in philosophy and education, and has the distinction of being the first UWI Open Campus online doctoral student, Doctor of Education, from the UWI Open Campus, Anguilla. And we look forward to the day when that commencement ceremony arrives, not too far down the road, where we can say to Michelle, well done. So Michelle, I invite you now to introduce our speaker for this evening.
The pleasure is mine to introduce our featured speaker, who, after my taking a quick scan of her bio, is, in my opinion, a luminary in so many respects. Dr. Emily Gaynor Dick-Forde is an accounting and governance expert with over 23 years of experience within the University of the West Indies. Dr. Dick-Forde was appointed a government senator and Minister of Planning, Housing and the Environment in the People's National Movement Government of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, 2007 to 2010, under the leadership of Mr. Patrick Manning. In this role, she was appointed governor for Trinidad and Tobago to the Inter-American Development Bank and to the Caribbean Development Bank. She has had the honor to address audiences on, inter alia, corporate social responsibility, ethical leadership, climate change and education in the Caribbean, strategic management, accounting, and environmental issues at events such as the Commonwealth Heads of Government Business Forum 2009, the Inter-American Development Bank Annual Meeting 2009, the Institute of Chartered Accountants of the Caribbean Conferences 2006 and 2012, and at numerous other academic and professional conferences. Dr. Dick-Forde is currently the head of the Program Planning Department at the University of the West Indies Open Campus. She has experience in the banking sector and is a certified management accountant with the Society of Management Accountants of Canada, now the Chartered Professional Accountants of Canada. Dr. Dick-Forde holds a PhD in accounting from the University of Dundee, Scotland, a master's degree in finance from the University of Cambridge, England, and a Bachelor of Science degree in accounting with first class honors from the University of the West Indies, Cave Hill campus. She has published journal articles and a book chapter on corporate social and environmental responsibility, climate change, and management accounting. Currently, she is writing a paper on responsible governance of credit unions. Dr. Dick-Forde is a fellow of the Cambridge Commonwealth Trust and a scholarship winner with the Cambridge Commonwealth Trust, the Association of Commonwealth Universities, and the University of Dundee, Scotland International Student Scholarship. She is also a fellow of the Chartered Professional Accountants of Canada. Dr. Dick-Forde is married and has 3 children. Please welcome to the podium our featured speaker, Dr. Emily G. Dick-Forde.
Thank you, Ms. Queeley. Good evening, everyone. A special good evening to the acting governor and to the acting chief minister, as well as the representative, and certainly to the head table, the board, the chairman of the Social Security Board, as well as the director, Mr. Hodge, a very friendly and helpful person. I want to say to God be the glory for all that was just read there. That is all the glory goes to God, not me. If it sounds like if I'm some kind of shaker and mover, but it isn't. The married with 3 children part is the most important part for me. It takes up all of my time. I want to stick to my script so that we can keep the time. I am especially thankful that there are so many young people. I'm glad that we have older people like me here, but it's good to have the youth here because it's very, very important. I hope that we can really get into this, and I especially look forward to the conversation after I'm finished with the script. I think that's the most important part. So I'm very grateful to the organizers of this distinguished lecture for a number of reasons. I must say that the hospitality arrangements have exceeded my expectations. Anguilla is now firmly on my list of places to bring my family for a long and enjoyable holiday. And I'm very serious about that. I really like what I've seen just coming across on the water and the very helpful guys who were in the ferry. I mean, they told me all sorts of things, including that all the mountains that I see in St. Martin were stolen from Anguilla. That's what they told me. I especially thank Mr. Hodge and his team from the Anguilla Social Security Board for their visionary approach to leading this most important institution. I want to formally congratulate the Anguilla Social Security Board, Mr. Hodge, and the leadership and members of the Anguilla Social Security Board on this 35th anniversary week of celebration 36th, and I pray that they will realize all that they have so carefully planned for and worked to implement for the people of Anguilla through this institution. It is my hope that this lecture can in some small way assist them in their push forward to excellence in the provision of social protection for all, especially to the most vulnerable amongst us. I must also express special thanks to the acting chief minister and the executive council, and as well as His Excellency acting governor, for taking the time to receive us for a courtesy call earlier today. I appreciated the brief encounter with the leaders of government here in Anguilla. I am so pleased that Dr. Banks accepted the suggestion for me to be her speaker this year, because you know she could have told him, nah, but she didn't. I'm also very proud to be a member of the UWI Open Campus, having met the excellent team at the site office here in Anguilla. I want to thank Dr. Banks, Arlene, and Tisha for their excellent hospitality. I'm also thankful to the two radio stations that took the time to prepare and host us for brief conversations to promote tonight's lecture. Thanks to DJ Hammer, I've never been interviewed by a DJ, so it felt good, at 92.9 FM, and Kenval Richardson of Radio Anguilla, respectively. Thanks, guys, for great conversations this morning. The topic that Mr. Hodge and his team chose for this 36th anniversary lecture is at the cutting edge of thinking and strategic action for nations and institutions globally. Indeed, in preparing for the lecture, I gained a deeper insight into the many issues involved in the social security system and its link to the UN Sustainable Development Goals. So as I set out to integrate the ideas and ideals of sustainability and social security systems, I also discovered a curious nexus between them. Social security systems in particular, the pay-as-you-go funding method, So this is just a little cartoon to keep you occupied while I get into it. So as I set out to integrate the ideas and ideals of sustainability and social security systems, I also discovered a curious nexus between those two concepts, those two systems. Social security systems, especially the pay-as-you-go funding method, establish a liability for future generations, a burden, in fact, to meet the needs of current-day working-age citizens who will be the senior citizens of the future. On the other hand, you may hear the link for yourself. The popular definition for sustainable development is, and I quote, development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. And it's very important that we take note of the that part of the definition that says to meet their own needs. So while we have focused in social security to some extent on the future generation meeting the needs of senior citizens who are currently working age persons, sustainable development is saying development, sustainable development is development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. That's the Brundtland report. Sustainable development, and this is a continuation of a full quote that I took, sustainable development implies economic growth together with the protection of environmental quality, each reinforcing the other. The essence of this form of development is a stable relationship between human activities and the natural world, which does not diminish the prospects for future generations to enjoy a quality of life at least as good as our own. And you're going to hear that repeating all the time, that whole notion of as good as what we have. So it is about preserving and sending forward, not less than what we have received. In fact, we should enhance it. Many observers believe that participatory democracy, undominated by vested interests, is a prerequisite for achieving sustainable development. Now, these are very lofty ideals, but we're going to break it down as we go forward. The continued sustainability and viability of your social security system for the benefit of generations of Anguillans requires responsible leaders and responsible citizens. Social security systems, with their transgenerational intentions, must embrace, emulate, and enable sustainable development in its deepest meaning. In so doing, social security institutions would be securing the capacity of future generations to meet the liabilities imposed upon them to provide social protection for prospective senior citizens, among other beneficiaries. Additionally, and most importantly to the sustainability concept, future generations must be enabled to meet their own needs as well. So we are to be interested in them meeting the liabilities imposed on them at this point in time and ensure through our pursuit of the sustainable development goals now that they can meet their own needs at least at the level that we enjoy and better. Sustainable development, therefore, imposes a responsibility on the current generation, while Social Security imposes a liability on future generations. We accountants will call that the two sides must be in balance. We will say that the two sides must be in balance for the accounts to be credible. And I think that what the Social Security Board in Anguilla is seeking to do certainly seeks to balance the accounts, and I'm very, very thankful for that. In this lecture, therefore, I shall share with you on the assigned topic of the social protection and on social protection and the UN's sustainable development goals from the perspective of that insight on the nexus between sustainable development and social security. Additionally, I shall introduce the UN's sustainable development goals with a brief history that links their genesis in the Millennium Development Goals. I shall then provide an overview of the 17 goals that comprise the UN Sustainable Development Goals, along with a discussion of the targets created to give focus to the goals and encourage adoption and action toward goal achievement. Towards the end, we will have, as I said, that conclusions, questions, and comments, which is really, really important. I provide a critical comment on the goals because there was something that bothered me about what I was reading in one of the goals, and I will discuss it a bit later. And it's something I really want to hear, get some dialogue on as we come to that point. The integration of the Sustainable Development Goals and Social Security demands a commitment and a plan to adopt the SDGs as strategy toward transforming the Anguilla Social Security Board, and indeed the nation of Anguilla itself. I did my little academic thing. I asked a little question of the IT guy who is from the Anguilla Social Security Board. I said, are you all reducing paper use? He said, you all are beginning to put something in place to do that. So there are certain things that you have to begin doing. As you saw with that climate change cartoon, it is not just about somebody going to hit the nuclear button. It really is, what are we doing as individuals? It is everything that we do that brings us closer to a sustainable world. So we shall therefore briefly consider some applications by looking at specific targets and speaking to the Anguillan situation. As an educator, I am also duty-bound to include opportunities for further reading and continuing education, some of which can be accessed via the UWI Open Campus, a shameless plug I just did there. So I turn now to a discussion on the UN Sustainable Development Goals as successor to the Millennium Development Goals. You may have heard about the MDGs that went before, so I'm going to just make that link briefly. At an historic UN summit in September 2015, world leaders adopted the 17 Sustainable Development Goals. And on January 1st, 2016, the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals officially came into force with a date for achievement set as the year 2030. Over the next 15 years, these new goals that universally apply to all countries will be deployed to mobilize efforts to end all forms of poverty, fight inequalities, and tackle climate change while ensuring that no one is left behind. No one includes both current and future generations, which is the lifeblood of the concept of sustainability. So whenever you hear the concept of sustainability, understand that you are talking across generations. You're not speaking at all only about what's before us now. So it is a transgenerational concept. The extent of work done by the UN to present the SDGs as applicable to all countries, implementable and time-bound, may well be related to the experience with the Millennium Development Goals. The UN Millennium Declaration was adopted at the Millennium Summit in September 2000 by what was described at the time as the largest gathering of world leaders in history. leaders committed their nations to a new global partnership to reduce extreme poverty and to set out a series of time-bound targets with a deadline of 2015. The Millennium Development Goals presented quantified targets for addressing extreme poverty in its many dimensions, which include income poverty, hunger, disease, lack of adequate shelter, and exclusion. The MDGs also promoted gender equality, education, and environmental sustainability. The MDGs were described as representing basic human rights. These are the rights of each person on the planet to health, education, shelter, and security. The MDGs were captured in 8 goals. Goal 1 was to eradicate extreme hunger and poverty. Goal 2, achieve universal primary education. Goal 3, promote gender equality and empower women. Goal 4, reduce child mortality. Goal 5, improve maternal health. Goal 6, combat HIV/AIDS, malaria, and other diseases. Goal 7, ensure environmental sustainability. And goal 8, develop a global partnership for development. The focus of the MDGs was on developing nations. Based on reporting systems established by the United Nations to receive reports from all developed nations, developing nations, the overall view is that significant progress was made toward achieving many of the MDGs. The UN Millennium Development Project website reports that the number of people in extreme poverty declined by an estimated 130 million. The reported statistics are as follows. Child mortality rates fell from 103 deaths per 1,000 live births a year to 88 deaths. Life expectancy rose from 63 years to nearly 65 years. An additional 8% of the developing world's people received access to water, and that's an additional 8% on what existed before, and an additional 15% acquired access to improved sanitation services. And I got that from the Millennium Development Project website. However, the MDG project reports that progress has been far from uniform across the world or across the goals, the 8 goals that I listed. There are huge disparities across and within countries. Within countries, poverty is greatest for rural areas, though urban poverty is also extensive, growing, and underreported by traditional indicators. I extracted a little report from a report on the Eastern Caribbean done by Professor Andrew Downs, and I am quoting therefore from this Millennium Development Goals and the Eastern Caribbean, which covered Anguilla as well. An assessment of the MDGs indicates that some degree of progress has been made with respect to the achievement of some of the goals. For example, reduction of extreme poverty and hunger, universal primary level education, gender equality, and improved maternal health. Some degree of effort would be needed for the other goals to be fully achieved by the year 2015. And this report was done in 2005, so that's 10 years before the actual end of the Millennium Development Goal achievement date. However, note that the Caribbean, the Eastern Caribbean, and certainly all of the Caribbean had in fact improved on a number of the indicators. One approach would be the development of a balanced scorecard. So they're suggesting here that a balanced scorecard should have been done, which would link the goals in a systematic manner and provide critical success factors needed for strategy formulation and goal achievement. And that's Andrew Downs, and it's Downs and Downs, 2003, and the report was released in 2005. One author in 2015, Kola, considers that the Sustainable Development Goals represent a broadening of the MDGs. For instance, the Sustainable Development Goals, unlike the Millennium Development Goals, are being implemented by all nations rather than developing nations only. Indeed, even the private sector is being engaged in the pursuit of the SDGs by the year 2030. So the MDGs will focus on developing countries, The SDGs are focused on everyone, developing, developed, as well as private institutions, I should say, as well as institutions. Kohler notes further that the sustainable development goals can be divided. The sustainable development goals can be divided into three types. One, those that marginally enhance the MDGs. Two, goals that focus on the environment, the economy, and the sustainability. And three, normative or ideal goals that move way beyond the MDGs. In my personal opinion, I see these SDGs as building on the solid foundation laid by the MDGs to promote an urgency to help the poor and vulnerable, even as we work to improve the lived experience of all citizens. So in my considered opinion, the MDGs represented an important initiative by the UN to spotlight the need for social protection for citizens in developing countries. There was a particular focus on uplifting the lived experiences of citizens in the poorest nations. Yet, there were challenges with the MDGs. There was a view that the goals represented conditions that were already achieved by many Caribbean countries. For example, the goal related to primary and secondary education. Another concern was that the MDGs, with its focus on developing countries, excluded direct involvement and support from developed countries. Additionally, the most vulnerable in developed countries were in need of focused help to lift their lived experiences as much as persons from developing countries. Because we are aware that in developed countries there are pockets, in fact sometimes whole communities of very, very poor people. And the SDGs is going to force those countries to have a look at and to improve the living conditions of the poorest persons in developed countries as well. So the SDGs, unlike the MDGs, applies to all nations. They apply to all nations. I turn now to an overview of the 17 broad goals that comprise the UN Sustainable Development Goals. From my research, I have determined that a tremendous amount of work has been done and is indeed ongoing to ensure that the UN SDGs are implemented with a system of monitoring and reporting toward goal achievement by the year 2030. The UN and related partners have provided 17 clearly articulated goals, each with well-developed targets. In total, there are about 168 targets across the 17 SDGs. The 17 SDGs in short form are as follows. Number one is to end poverty. Number two, to end hunger. And note that the two are not the same. They might occur together, but they are not the same. They require different targets. Number three, good health and well-being. Four, quality education. Five, gender equality. Six, clean water and sanitation. Seven, affordable and clean energy. Eight, decent work and economic growth. Nine, industry, innovation and infrastructure. 10, reduce inequalities within and among countries. 11, sustainable cities and communities. Goal 12, responsible consumption and production. Goal 13, climate action. Goal 14, life below water. Goal 15, life on land. Goal 16, peace, justice, and strong institutions. And goal 17, partnerships for the goals. I've provided a handout in e-version of the 17 Sustainable Development Goals, each with their over 168 targets that go across the goals. I had to, I pulled it out of the internet because you had to keep clicking in order to see. So I took the time to pull it out, and you should have a handout from which the Open Campus can, you can let them know if you want an e-copy of it and they can send it to you. Now the targets articulated for each goal provide the level of detail required to assist nations and institutions to plan and implement initiatives toward achievement of these goals. I shall use the example of goal number three, which is good health. and well-being to illustrate the nature of targets. So we have 17 sustainable development goals, and each goal has a number of targets. They're not all the same number. So each goal has a number of targets, and the targets are written in a particular language. So I'm going to use this opportunity to show you what it looks like. And then the next set of targets I look at, I'll then be seeking to apply it to the Anguillan situation. So target number two, goal three, covers overall health. It talks about ensure healthy lives and promote well-being for all at all ages. So the goals are written like this. You have a short form, and the short form is the large font that you see there, good health and well-being. And then you have a long form of the goal, which is the first bullet point that says ensure healthy lives and promote well-being for all at all ages. Now, all of this was on the internet. Eh? I didn't have to go and buy a book to do anything. It was all readily available online. So you have short form of the goal. You have the long form of the goal, which is the next line. And then the next bullet point, just under target, that is the first target. And the targets are then numbered 3.1, 3.2, and so on. So the first target says by 2030, reduce the global maternal mortality ratio to less than 70 per 100,000 live births. So that under health and well-being, the first target is to address maternal mortality. And for those who are little babies here, maternal mortality means women dying in childbirth. You heard that I have three children. Because I took the time to read everything I could find every time I got pregnant, and I'm very serious. The doctor used to laugh when I come in with my notebook, with all my information written down, that everything that happened to me, everything that I experienced in the month that I didn't see him. And he used to laugh, and he said, all pregnant ladies should do this. Because I'm reading all sorts of books, and anything that happened, I'm writing it down and I'm coming. It's very important that there be knowledge, first of all, and that whole thing about maternal deaths is a big thing. A lot of women die in childbirth around the world, including in Trinidad and Tobago. I don't know what the record is here in Anguilla, but in our country, people feel that the Mount Hope Hospital is like a graveyard because people go in and they don't come out, especially pregnant mothers. So this is a very important goal that needs to be pursued. I will tell you, Trinidad and Tobago, I don't know your situation, but it's one that has to be followed. That's how important these SDGs are. They get to the very heart of people's lived experiences. So a date is given. So apart from the outlining of the target, a date is given by which the initiatives are to show the desired result. So the desired outcome is the reduction of maternal deaths. The target measure is expressed as a proportion, which is 70 per 100,000 live births. It is therefore very important that as we look at the 17 goals, that the targets created for each goal must be seen as integral to a serious approach to achieving these goals by the year 2030, the year by which the UN seeks to achieve these goals. Note that some targets are set for achievement before 2030. Some targets include a 2020 deadline date. And so they are not saying everything has to be 2030. There are some things that they know can be achieved before, and they're encouraging countries to achieve it before the 2030 date. Now, I'm taking the time to go through this, and I'm stepping off script simply to say that it means that for the Anguilla Social Security Board, for institutions represented here, for government leaders, the SDGs and their targets are very accessible. You don't have to, it's not rocket science. So you can pull it up, have a look, and I'll give some examples as well, both for ASSB as well as for government ministers. Another example of SDG targets linked to goals is provided from Goal 2. Goal 2, which is to end hunger, has the long form information, end hunger, achieve food security, and improve nutrition and promote sustainable agriculture. We're going to look at target 2.3 and target 2.4. Target 2.3 says by 2030, double the agricultural productivity and incomes of small-scale food producers, in particular women, indigenous peoples, family farmers, pastoralists, and fishers, including through secure and equal access to land, other productive resources and inputs, knowledge, financial services, markets, and opportunities for value addition and non-farm employment. Now, that is real detail. And therefore, it means that to facilitate food, increasing your local production in food, you simply need to look in here and then begin to use this to help your national strategic plan to actually be speaking more directly to the achievement of the SDGs. And then 2.4, by 2030, ensure sustainable food production systems and implement resilient agricultural practices that increase productivity and production, that help maintain ecosystems, that strengthen capacity for adaptation to climate change, extreme weather, drought, flooding, and other disasters, and that progressively improve land and soil quality. In Trinidad and Tobago, when I was the minister with responsibility for the environment, we signed off on a loan and technical support from the World Bank to rehabilitate a swamp area that had been, it was a swamp area with a lot of rainforest, and it had been under severe attack by persons cutting down all the trees and planting rice. And in planting rice in there, they were actually changing the ecosystem tremendously. And a swamp area is critical for, as a carbon sequestration site. Swamp area actually pulled down a lot of the carbon into the, under the ground. So if you cut down the trees, you're actually cutting down your capacity for cleaning up the environment. And it's in a country like Trinidad, energy country, you actually need more swamp area, more rainforest area to be able to offset the energy, the damage that's being done to the environment by the amount of energy we use and extraction and so on. And so there are mechanisms that can be used to address the issues listed here, 2.4. And that's where, when we come towards the end, the partnership part of the goals, which is number 17, actually gives you an opportunity to see how developing countries like Anguilla can partner with both developed countries and institutions to set up projects that will address these items identified here in 2.4. Now, let me get more specific now. These two targets, 2.3 and 2.4, were chosen to help illustrate the application, remember we talked about application in the title, of these goals and targets to our institutions and nations. Now, I began this lecture by noting the nexus between social security systems and the most popular definition for sustainable development. Both social security and sustainable development have an interest in the earning capacity of future generations. I noted that in a pay-as-you-go national insurance social security system, a liability is ascribed to future generations to meet the needs of present-day workers. These present-day workers currently provide contributions that go toward payments to senior citizens of today. I noted also that the definition of sustainable development seeks to ensure that future generations have access to at least the same level of resources to pursue an acceptable quality of life and livelihoods for themselves. This need to ensure that the needs of future generations are to be satisfied must be pursued with zeal, or the social security system will crash. My reading of targets 2.3 and 2.4 point to these areas as ones to which the Anguilla Social Security Board can pay particular interest. The ASSB can seek to assist its contributors who are in the field of agriculture by linking them to resources that can help increase their productivity. In so doing, the contributions to the social security system improves. ASSB can in this way contribute to this economic sustainability of Anguilla and to the resource management support needed by current contributors to the system. And this is one of the things that the SDG promotes, this whole notion of meaningful work and sustainable work. And I'll mention that again a little later. Additionally, the Anguilla Social Security Board should articulate a sustainable development policy. And based on what I'm hearing, it's on the way to do things like that, which incorporate climate change, environmental, and social issues for implementation in its own institution towards sustainable practices. I would have to say more sustainable practices because I'm quite impressed with what they're doing already. Additionally, the Anguilla Social Security Board can model the way as a leader and seek to influence its stakeholders, in particular its supply chain and contributors, toward more sustainable solutions in their own operations. So whenever you are a leader like this board, you not only transform your own institution, but you influence others to do the same through those who are your suppliers in whatever way. And certainly in the Anguilla Social Security Board's case, they can influence and assist contributors to do the same as well. The SDGs promote human development, which focus on the richness of human life. Sustainable work is a major building block for sustainable development. And so it's very important that there is some connection made between the board and its contributors to ensure, to help them to have to actually increase their productivity, to do their work better, and all of that leads to a more sustainable society. Human development and sustainable work become critical in the link between social security and the ability of future generations to fund the pension and benefits for tomorrow's senior citizens. That's the point that is being made all the time in the link between social security and sustainable development. There must be a focus on creating and encouraging innovation for and pursuit of meaningful work that improve lives and livelihoods for generations of Anguillans going forward. So I turn now to look at the SDGs from the perspective of national governance. We want to take a look at goal number 4, which is quality education, and specifically targets 4.6 and 4.7. Target 4.6 says by 2030, ensure that all youth and a substantial proportion of adults, both men and women, achieve literacy and numeracy. Sometimes we are quite surprised at the number of persons who are not educated beyond even a low-level primary, and I'm talking about in Trinidad and Tobago. You still have some people in Barbados and you have people across the islands when we work as an open campus. So we have developed a program called Access Courses. It's not really a program, they are courses that actually seek to assist persons to come up to speed in numeracy and literacy, and they will be online. You can hear more about it. We are beginning from January 2017 to deliver these courses. Then target 4.7 by 2030, ensure that all learners acquire the knowledge and skills needed to promote sustainable development, including, among others, through education for sustainable development and sustainable lifestyles. We actually have to educate ourselves to lead sustainable lifestyles. Human rights, gender equality, promotion of a culture of peace and nonviolence, global citizenship and appreciation of cultural diversity and of culture's contribution to sustainable development. So these two targets jumped out at me as two of the targets for the government of Anguilla to pursue immediately, if not already in train. They require a commitment of people and resources. Immediately, I can suggest courses and programs at the UWI Open Campus, another shameless plug, that meet some of the needs in Target 4.6. We are commencing online courses, as I said, the Access courses, and we are beginning with mathematics and English. So these courses are designed for persons who do not have O-level passes in these subjects for whatever reason, and also for persons who need remedial work to improve their literacy and numeracy skills. The courses also help mature students to be ready to pursue degree programs within the UWI. Additionally, at the undergraduate level, we have a course titled Principles of Sustainable Development, which is a course in our Behavioral Sciences program, BSc Sociology, BSc Psychology, and BSc Political Science. So it's an undergraduate level 2 course called Principles of Sustainable Development. The course can be taken as a single course by persons entering as specially admitted students. At the graduate level, we have 2 courses in the Master's in Management program titled Responsible Leadership, and the other one is Sustainable Financial Management. So the Open Campus has also offered a certificate program in climate change designed and delivered online in partnership with the Center for Resource Management and Environmental Studies, CERMES, at our Cave Hill campus. So these are all online courses and programs and therefore require commitment and funding to pursue the studies with no need to leave home. We can certainly partner with our constituents across the region to design and deliver online and face-to-face programs and courses in sustainable development and related topics that facilitate the achievement of Goal 4 and in particular Target 4.7. Target 4.7 is a very, very important part of pursuing sustainable development goals as a nation. Education for sustainable development is a critically important step for there to be a set of persons convinced of the importance of achieving the SDGs and championing the pursuit of these goals in every sector of national life. These examples of where the Anguilla Social Security Board and indeed the national government and other institutions can contribute to sustainable development in Anguilla are consistent with ensuring a financially viable and sustainable social security system in Anguilla for many generations. This is the essence of the SDGs: to achieve social protection for current and future generations. A sustainable social security system requires that everything be done now, at every level, and by everyone to provide the same or better resources for future generations. In this way, we ensure that future generations should be well positioned to meet and even exceed the social security needs of the future and meet their own needs. You realize how many times I'm repeating the same thing, because that's the essence of sustainability. I took note that the tagline for the Anguilla Social Security Board is, and I quote, improving the quality of life for all. This is the declared focus of the ASSB. From my reading of your 2012 guide, you seek to provide a full set of social safety net benefits for sickness, invalidity, maternity, unemployment, retirement, survivors' benefits, among others. This represents a full range of social protection. Such an undertaking requires a number of critical elements, including responsible leadership, competent staff, sound systems of corporate governance, strategic planning for goal alignment across the organization, and for goal achievement. All of these elements, I can assume, are in place based on the expression of commitments in the documents that I have encountered. Where I believe there is scope for improvement is in the integration of the concepts, ideals, and goals of sustainable development to put the Anguilla Social Security Board at the cutting edge of what it means to be a sustainable organization. The goals and intentions articulated in the UN Sustainable Development Goals can provide the catalyst to move the Anguilla Social Security Board and the Anguillan society as a whole toward a path to sustainable development. A most important function that Mr. Hodge and his team has is to safeguard the social security system in Anguilla from financial crises. This can be done by embracing the related concepts and practices of ethical investments and ethical leadership practices. Tomorrow we cover this area in a half-day seminar, and I mention it here as financial sustainability and responsible financial management is central to a sustainable social safety net. Now, we heard about the whole ATM comment that was made from Trinidad. What happened after that left Trinidad unable, I won't go into the politics, but left Trinidad unable to help its neighbors. And that's one of the principles of that always led leaders in Trinidad always had, that we were there to help others. Because one of the things Mr. Manning always said was, our main market is the Caribbean. And therefore, we have to help the Caribbean to be sustainable, because that's our market. Apart from the fact that we have to help our, we have to be our brother's keeper. But right now, Trinidad and Tobago is itself in trouble because of poor, I would have to say, irresponsible leadership. So over the past decades, corporate failures have resulted from moral failures and irresponsible management. The main victims of these failures were the most vulnerable persons, including pension fund members and minority homeowners. In the Caribbean, the failure of CLECO and British American Insurance were as spectacular for us as was the fall of Lehman Brothers and Enron for the US and the global financial system. As a fund manager, the Anguillan Social Security Board must have taken note of these failures and the high risk of trusting the system as currently operated. Ethical investments and wise financial management are critical for a sustainable Anguilla. And I think you're all going to like this next part I'm going to say here now. Concluding comments. So I'm coming to a close. Notice that this little cartoon, which is to give us a little break, this is a memo on cutting paper usage in the office. But look how much paper he's using. So we have to be sensible about SDGs. It is not rocket science, as I keep saying, and it really is getting the education, and this is the beginning, getting the education that you need to understand what sustainability means and how do you make your contribution as an individual and then moving forward as a nation to implement these things. And the SDGs are very accessible. You read it, you see the targets, and you can actually pick out as a person, you can pick out what you can contribute to. And really, they want you to contribute to all. We need it to be a holistic thing. So concluding comments. As I conclude this conversation on the UN, SDGs, and social protection, I note that there's a wealth of material and resources online to help a willing society, because we have to be willing to do it, and institutions to do their part toward the achievement of these goals. Indeed, I am especially heartened by the consistent focus and mention of the need to look after the needs of the poor and most vulnerable in society. That's something that I kept seeing over and over in the SDG targets. I intended to count how many times this focus is mentioned, but I gave up counting when I realized that this is the focus of one or more targets in each of the 17 Sustainable Development Goals. This is of particular importance to me since it suggests that the underlying assumptions and ideals that shaped these SDGs are in keeping with what the creator wanted. In my PhD dissertation on environmental accounting, corporate social responsibility and reporting, which I completed in 1999, I placed the following quote at the front of the page, and I quote, "To be a Christian is to look at the world through the lens of the cross and thereby keep one's focus on human suffering." And this is a quotation from Dr. Cornel West, an American pragmatist and social theorist. I believe that the SDGs seek to do just that and therefore compels us to be our brothers and sisters keepers as we lead and govern countries, communities, and corporations. I, however, must raise one issue that I believe needs amendments in the Sustainable Development Goals. Remember, as an academic, or as a person, you don't ever read things and think that everything that somebody wrote is, everything is right. You must always use a critical eye, and my critical eye raised a concern when I read the SDGs. As the mother of a young man aged 23, I am always sensitive to the needs of young men in today's society and the struggles that they encounter in seeking to live quality, wholesome lives. From my reading of Goal 5, Gender Equality, and the related targets, I concur in the need to protect women and girls as articulated. Yet I find the gender targets problematic in their silence on issues that affect the welfare of men and boys. I believe that there should be targets for ensuring the welfare of this most important gender, especially when prisons and street dwellers in many nations are mainly males. when I go through Trinidad and Tobago, young men, either they fill the prisons or they're sleeping on the road. And similarly, I went to Barbados recently, and I never saw vagrants in Barbados until my last visit. There are lots of vagrants in Barbados, and they are all men. And I think that if you have a goal to improve the lives of all citizens, and you have a gender goal, that gender goal must speak to all genders, not just females. So I believe that there should be targets for ensuring the welfare of men. So as Anguilla takes on the SDGs, I would advise that an assessment be done, if it is not already available, of the particular issues affecting the welfare of men and boys, and that targets to address those issues be articulated and included under Goal 5. Because the targets that are there are not exhaustive. It doesn't mean that you have to only do those. It means that you can come up with actually a guide showing you what you can do, how you can go about, you know, coming up with your own goals. And this thing is very important to me, because I really find that sometimes the agendas in UN issues, yes, they have consulted widely, but we in the Caribbean need to sound our voice, and it is a particular Caribbean issue. We have an issue with helping our young men, our men and boys, to realize their full potential. So I have explored this topic given to me, and I'm enlightened by the research and writing that I had to do to prepare for this event, because I learned quite a lot, and I hope you did too. I hope that as I delivered what I learned, that you were able to glean something from this exchange. I shall end here to provide an opportunity for questions and comments, and it is in this segment of our conversation where learning occurs. I just want to show what's on the screen. I want to leave us with this quote by Isabel Ortiz, head of the ILO's Social Protection Department, that's the International Labour Organization. Imagine a world where all older persons receive a pension, a world where all persons with severe disabilities receive benefits for a life in dignity. Imagine a world where all women receive maternity and child support so children can eat, study, and play. A world where there is support for those who are poor or without jobs. A world where no one is left behind. This is the world we want in 2030. A world with no poverty and fewer inequalities. A world with social protection for all. This world is feasible. In recent years, there has been massive progress in developing social protection systems. Many developing countries have achieved universal or near universal coverage for all people. It is about continuing on that path. So I want to thank you for your patience listening to me, and I'm going to receive questions, but let me go and sit down and I'll receive the questions from at the table. Thank you very much.
On behalf of the Anguilla Social Security Board, we would like to give you this token as our appreciation to you for an informative and educational lecture. Thank you so much again, and do enjoy the rest of your time here in Anguilla.
Thank you very much.
In all things, we must give thanks. And I know the night has been long, so I'll be short. Dr. Dick-Forde prefaced her presentation tonight by giving thanks, thanking us for our hospitality. And I will now continue and give the vote of thanks for tonight's event. And I will start with thanking Dr. Dick-Forde for such a wonderful presentation, for bringing home the Sustainable Development Goals, a pragmatic application to Anguilla, and really tying in social security, Anguilla Social Security Board's role and responsibility. So thank you very much for that, Dr. Dick-Forde. I would like to thank Dr. Fleming Banks for so ably chairing this evening's proceedings, for thanks to Mr. Perry Hughes, our inspector at Social Security, for the national song. To Mr. Hodge, the director of Social Security, for his remarks and the invocation. And to Ms. Queeley, doctoral student of the UWI Open Campus, for her introduction of Dr. Dick-Forde tonight. I would like to thank you, the audience, because without you, this would not have been possible. And we thank you for braving the weather. We know that Anguillans are known to be dry weather people. And so when it rains, we stay indoors. But we thank you for braving the weather and coming out and supporting Social Security Board and the UWI Open Campus second annual distinguished lecture, and for your participation in the discussion, especially our young people, the students at the high school. Thanks to our alternate board member, Ms. Marva Smith, for her presentation to Dr. Dick-Forde. I hope you enjoy it, a token of our appreciation. And I would like to thank the media, who played a great part in promoting our event, and who has been promoting all our events for Social Security Week, Radio Anguilla, for the live broadcast tonight and their promotion of our events for the week, Mr. Wycliffe Richardson of ATV for the videography tonight, Class FM and New Beginning Radio Grace FM for their promotion in our events, of our events for the week. And of course, to our Social Security staff who have been working behind the scenes to make this event possible, and also for a week of activities. Our IT department, our two-man IT department of Romero Kelsick and Kenvis Gums, for their assistance, to Paul Fleming, to Maglan Richardson, and the other members of staff who assisted. To the UWI Open Campus staff of three, Dr. Fleming Banks, and her staff, Tisha Harrigan and Arlene Brown, for their hard work as well. And of course, to LaVue staff for hosting us and providing the wonderful accommodation to Dr. Dick-Forde and the refreshments which you are about to partake in short. And if I omitted anyone, I apologize, but thanks to everyone.